Half-a-day students, I am Governor Lou Leon Guerrero. You all have been through a year of big changes. We've had to adapt and make big changes to keep our families and our island safe. But with change comes opportunity and a chance to try new things like PBS University. While Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio and I will continue to do our part to keep our island safe, you students have a part to play as well. Your part is to keep learning and to keep up with your lessons. That's why I am happy to see you here ready to learn with PBS University. PBS University is a way to bring a continuous educational curriculum to you while you stay safe at home during this time. To help you keep up with your studies, we asked our friends at PBS Guam and the Guam Department of Education to put together this episode. Thank you for doing your part and have a great lesson.
PBS University is a program by PBS Guam and the Guam Department of Education in conjunction with public school teachers. These lessons are created to provide both parents and students with a unique educational experience while helping students to continue learning at home. PBS University, next on PBS Guam.
1, 2, 3, 4!
Come along, let's sing a song, we'll have a great adventure. We'll have a great adventure.
Numbers,
letters,
science, things, all that we can do. Help you deal with how you feel. Share with us too.
It's super cool and just like school.
Our awesome learning adventures. So grab a friend, the fun will end. Our awesome learning adventures. Awesome learning adventures. University.
Welcome aboard Flight PBS University Literacy. This is Captain Shippy speaking. The final destination of our flight, the literacy flight today, is Idioms, and the duration of this flight, roughly 7 to 8 minutes. Idioms are a form of figurative language. Figurative language is just a way of saying things that we don't take literal, which means the words that are being used aren't the actual words that you mean. Writers and speakers, they use it for dramatic effect. So, put yourself on autopilot and enjoy. Autopilot. Autopilot is a form of an idiom. It means you have done it so many times that you don't really even pay attention to doing it anymore. That's not what we want. We definitely want you guys paying attention for this one, because idioms are important. So, with that said, let's take flight. Wait, take flight. We're watching TV. That's not what's happening. We're not actually flying. That is another form of an idiom. Autopilot, take flight, captain. See where I'm going here? You see this? Okay, good. So, idioms. Take flight means let's get going. It's not the literal words that I mean. It's the meaning behind it. It changes things. So idioms are figurative language. Means not the actual words being said. The meaning is different. Okay, so that's two of them. Let's take a look at some other examples. Ghost town. There's just a bunch of ghosts roaming around the town, like scaring people. No! It's basically just an area that is completely empty. When the shutdown happened, Tumon was a ghost town. Bite your tongue. We don't literally mean to bite your tongue. That's gonna hurt. Right? So we just mean don't talk. Bite your tongue just simply means don't say anything.
Blah, 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 blah. Captain Shippy, I fly planes, blah, blah, blah.
Tell you one thing, that Captain Shippy guy, he better watch his step when he talks to me, that's for sure. When I say watch his step when he talks to me, what do I mean? Do I mean every time that he's walking, like, oh, look down, watch where I'm going, have a conversation, okay, look on... I don't mean that. Of course I don't mean that. What do I mean then? That's a form of an idiom, right? It means he needs to be careful. He needs to be careful when he talks to me. Whatever. It's an idiom. It's a form of expression, right? Figurative. He doesn't need to literally watch his step every time. He just needs to be careful. I'm just playing around though. That pilot shippy guy, he's pretty all right. I'm okay with him. We've met a few times. I kind of like him. He's cool. Although, I did scare him to death one time. Scare him to death? Did I really scare him to death? It's another idiom, right? Of course. I mean, he was alive a second ago. I didn't scare him just now, right? So it's a form of an idiom. It means it scared him a lot. Does that make sense? It doesn't mean the literal words coming out of my mouth. It's just a figurative meaning. While I have you here, I want to tell you a little story. The other day, I had a date. And I know I'm this big, tough guy, scary looking, I've got a beard, I get it. But man, I tell you what, I had butterflies in my stomach. Butterflies in my stomach? What does that mean? Did I literally have butterflies? Obviously not, because we're talking about idioms. What does that mean? Right, it means I was nervous. I was nervous. That's what butterflies in your stomach means. Like, oh man, like, whoo, real nervous, like, and I should have been nervous. Man, she was drop dead gorgeous. So wait, drop dead gorgeous? Am I dating a zombie? She dead? When I look at her, does she kill me? I'm so confused. What does that mean? Drop dead gorgeous. Drop dead gorgeous just means, it simply means that she's super, super attractive. Like, woo, yeah. Like, crazy attractive. Woo-wee. I can't believe that biker shippy guy actually had a date with her. He is such a scaredy cat. I know he looks big and tough, but man, he's a scaredy cat. I didn't actually think he'd ask her out. Scaredy cat? So I'm saying he's a cat, not a person? He's got four legs instead of two? Of course not. What am I saying? Right. He's just a really scared person. That's all I'm saying. I mean, I tell you what, I really thought I'd see pigs fly before I ever saw him on a date with her. When pigs fly? I've never seen a pig fly. How does that work? What do we mean by that? Right? Obviously, pigs can't fly, so it means something that's never gonna happen, right? When pigs fly, never going to happen because pigs can't fly, right? Idiom. That's what it is. Figurative language, not literal. If we start seeing pigs fly, we might be in trouble. Okay, just saying. Well, when he told me he had his date with her, I told him, don't count your chickens before they hatch. Luckily for him, it really worked out. Count your chickens before they hatch? Man, what does that mean? No one ever knows what that means. Not true. I can tell you what it means. It means you want to make sure that you don't count it before it happens. The chickens haven't hatched yet. You can't say you have 15 of them if they haven't actually hatched yet. So don't count on something before it actually happens. You know, you're hoping you get 15 chickens, but maybe you don't. Before he went on his date though, I told him, make sure you don't pig out. That might disgust her, but I don't know what he did, because that guy, he sure does like his food. Don't pig out? I'm sure you guys have heard that one before. You know, don't eat too much. Pigging out means eating too much. I think you understand what that means. Right? Figurative language, not what we literally are saying. It means something else. Idioms. They're great to use in conversation. Super helpful. Thank you for flying with PBS University today. I hope you enjoyed your flight on Idioms, and I hope that you come again and fly with us one more time on PBS University. Go out there and use those idioms. It's important. And as always, I want to say thank you for watching. Stay safe, stay curious, and stay active. Get out there, guys. All right, see you later.
Hafaday, boys and girls. Thank you so much for being here. Hello and Lenwo, which is hello in Kashrayan. My name is Mrs. Castro, and welcome to another episode of Math with Mrs. Castro. I'm so happy you're here with me today. Let's get down to it. Let's bring in our images. What do you think we're learning about today? We're actually going to be doing something fun. So I have a riddle for you to give you another hint. What do you call a skeleton that makes you laugh? It's a funny bone. In today's class, we'll actually be learning about exponents, and we'll be working with how to say them and how to read them. And we'll also do a fun Halloween craft, and we'll hear a scary story that I'm going to tell. I'm so happy you're here with me today, and let's get to it. All right, let's go. Let's get started, everyone. In today's lesson, we will be learning about exponents, and we will be making a creepy Halloween craft, and we'll be making a DIY costume where we become scarecrows. So in today's lesson, you should be able to write and evaluate whole number exponents. What is an exponent? An exponent is the number of times the base number is multiplied by itself. Now we need to know, what does a base number and what does an exponent look like? It looks like this. So 5 is going to be our base number, and 2 is going to be our exponent. So that means that we are going to be multiplying 5 by itself 2 times. So let's evaluate. And remember that in math, evaluate is another way to say solve. So what is 5 to the second power? 5 to the second power equals 5 times 5, and that equals 25. So let's do a creepy Halloween word problem. As you can see in the picture, we have Lerna's Hydra, which is a mythological character. The Hydra was a one-headed monster, but when it was cut off, two more heads grew in its place. If a hero tried to conquer it by cutting off all of its heads every day, how many heads do you think the Hydra would have on the third day? So let's solve this using our knowledge of exponents. So we know that our Hydra has 2 heads every time that it is cut off. We want to know, how many heads will the Hydra have on the third day? So that means 2 is going to be our base number, and 3 is going to be our exponent, which means that we are multiplying 2 by itself 3 times. So what does that look like when we evaluate it? 2 times 2 times 2. And remember to multiply 2 numbers at a time to get the correct answer. 2 times 2 is 4, and 4 times 2 is 8. So that means on the third day, the Hydra will have 8 heads. Hi, boys and girls. As we make our creepy Halloween craft, I'm going to tell you a creepy story. So at my old school, I was staying back late and I was grading papers. To my right was another door that led to another class that was having an after school program. And while I was there, I was grading and the door was open. I could see the teacher and her students, and they were talking, the lights were on and everything. And then when I looked to my computer to do more grading, I decided to look to my right to look at the door, and for some reason, it was completely black. Like there was no one there, and that freaked me out because the teacher that I was roommates with, she usually says goodbye, and I thought I would have heard them leave. And so then I thought that was interesting, and then I looked back to my grading on my computer, and then I looked to the room again, and the lights were on and everyone was still in there. I thought that was so weird because just a second ago, the room was completely black, like everyone left. That freaked me out so much that I decided not to stay back late and grade anymore. What a creepy story. Let's do a fun DIY costume and become scarecrows. I start off by putting my hair into two pigtails. And you can either braid your hair or put it into pigtails, whatever you like to do. And then using any black liquid liner, you're going to draw patches on your face. So I start with a patch on my nose. And then after that, you are going to draw a patch on your mouth, following the natural lines that would happen if you were to smile. Then you draw those patches and those lines. You're almost your scarecrow self. Now you're gonna grab any blush, it could be liquid or cream, and you're gonna make it into circles on your cheeks and put a little bit on the patch on your nose. And then to emphasize my cream blush, I decided to put some powder blush to give me more emphasis and more color. And then you grab whatever plaid shirt you have and any straw or coconut hat that you have, and you're a scarecrow. Awesome.
So what did we learn about today? We learned how to read and write exponents. We also learned how to evaluate exponents. We also solved an exponent problem in a word problem. So the next time you see an exponent in a word problem or any other problem, you'll know how to solve it. And we also did a fun Halloween craft and listened to a scary story. I hope you're having a great day, and I hope you are safe and have a happy Halloween. Thank you so much for being here. Bye.
Hello, I'm Sci-Fi Safety Agent Castro, and welcome to a special Sci-Fi Corner, where we will be looking into a series of mysteries. Do you like solving mysteries? Exploring the unknown? Breaking secret codes? Encountering danger? Not if you are a sci-fi safety agent. And that is what you can become by the end of the case that we're going to try to solve. While we're out and about, we are going to safely solve these mysteries because it's all about safety. Say it with me. Safely for safety. In Palawan, the word koreng means to be careful. So how do we say be careful in Chamorro? Adahi. Being careful helps us to stay safe, especially when we go out into the world. It can get cold and dark. That's why we need to be agents of safety. So let's start the mission now, shall we?
It was a usual rainy day with scattered rain showers on this tropical island. I was at the office, working on PBS University stuff, and at about 7:34 p.m. on this cold October night at the Sci-5 headquarters, I received a secret email message. It was addressed to me, and my mission was to save the world, and I had to retrieve the safety kit from this address. So I immediately went to Google Earth, typed in the address, and I did a search. And it immediately zoomed in to a location in Tumon. I'm glad you joined me on this mission. So we're here in Tumon, in the parking garage. And what are we here to retrieve again? That's right, the safety kit. Great work. Now let's see what's in here. Okay, a bunch of safety stuff, flashlight, laser pen, and a ring light. Wait a minute, there's a secret message. Let's see what it says. Your mystery investigation is only in your head. It begins at night. Opens with cats' lives, and 11 times you will gain sight when you choose the safest light. So out of these three items, which one is the safest light? According to the Sci-Fi database, laser pointer beams, if pointed towards the eyes, can cause temporary or permanent blindness if it damages the retina. So it's a no-go on the laser pen. And the ring light? I don't think we're going to be filming ourselves. So what do you think is the safest light? I agree. It's the flashlight. What's that? You found a message inside the flashlight? And it reads, walk towards Marine Corps Drive, where you will meet the spy. Underneath a shade he waits, where you will take the bait. Here at the street corner. And could this be our guy? Could he be the spy? Is he under a shade? He just violated a bunch of safety rules. What are they? You're right, he did not use the crosswalk, look both ways, and he was jaywalking. What do we use to be safe? We gotta use the crosswalk. Thankfully, the exchange was made. When he walked past me, he handed me his umbrella, and that's where I saw the next secret message. This one read, go to the lab, find the evidence. The door will be opened by the guard, but it will be a biohazard. We quickly headed to the lab and encountered these three doors that had these symbols. Which is the symbol for biohazard? Correct, it's letter B. And right on schedule, the guard opened the door. You think the coast is clear? Okay, let's go. Let's sneak in. Good thing you chose the flashlight after all. Now let's go find the evidence. Oh no! Somebody got here before we did! Quickly, what do we use to safely extinguish this fire? Are you gonna use water? Are you gonna use paper, a fan, or a fire extinguisher? That's right, a fire extinguisher. Whew, so glad you were able to extinguish the fire before it consumed the evidence since there was no water around. Glad the evidence survived the fire. What is that now? You see that it has a combination lock. And you think the first letter that we received will give us a clue about the combination? So what verse do you think is going to give us a clue? I agree. I think it opens with cats' lives. So, how many lives do cats have? That's right, they have 9 lives. And what about 11 times? 9 and 11. What could that mean? So what could the number 911 be used for? Information? For emergency? For September 11 or an address? You're right. It's for an emergency. So let's go back to the letter again. Opens with cats, lives, and 11 times is 911. Could that be the combination to open up the suitcase? Let's give it a try. Well, what do you know? It opened it. And there's another secret message. And it reads, you've become a skilled agent in safety, protecting yourself and others by completing this task. You will solve this mystery to save the world by wearing this mask. Is correct. You just saved the world.
The world is a safer place now, now that you are a Psi 5 safety agent. So continue practicing applying safety rules at all times, whether you're in a group or you're by yourself, whether it be daytime or nighttime, be an agent of safety so that you can continue to discover, explore, respect, and restore. I'm Safety Agent Castro, signing out, and always Stay safe.
Half-a-day students, welcome to PBS University. My name is John Fernandez, and I'm the superintendent of the Guam Department of Education. These PBS University lessons are made to help you to continue learning. The teachers here prepared fun lessons on science, character education, math, English, and more, and they made it for you, the students of Guam. We're very grateful to them for their instruction. We're also thankful for you students, parents, and guardians who are watching. Remember, stay safe and healthy, and we'll see you soon in the next school year. Thank you.
Hey, there you are. How have you been? You know, over the years, I have had the pleasure of working with many diverse learners in the classroom, and we've learned so much from each other. So before we begin, I'd like to say this.
Ron Anim. Kumusta? Konnichiwa. Annyeonghaseyo. Talofa. Yorana. Mokdin. Pankom. Ali. Kasalele. Yakwe. Nihao.
In our last episode, we discussed how life was in colonial times, and with the holidays approaching, I thought it would be really cool to go back in time and see how the colonists celebrated Halloween. Did the citizens of colonial America celebrate Halloween? The answer is yes, but not in the way that you may think. Let me explain. Tradition started with the ancient Celtic festival of Samhain. The Celts believed that on October 31st, ghosts of the dead returned to the earth. Colonial Halloween parties also featured the telling of ghost stories and playing tricks of all kinds. These were the first Halloween parties. Colonists also used lanterns made from hollowed out pumpkin in which holes are cut out to represent facial features. October 31st was known by the colonists as All Hallows Eve. Later it became known as Halloween. Colonists dressed as saints or angels and would visit houses to receive pastries called soul cakes in exchange for a promise to pray for the souls of the homeowner's dead relatives. So yes, colonists did wear costumes. Were you wondering if other countries celebrated Halloween as well? In Mexico, they celebrate Dia de los Muertos, the Day of the Dead, to honor all their deceased ancestors. Many dress up as skeletons. In the Philippines on October 31st, it is common to bring candles, flowers, and food to the graves of their loved ones. In the Philippines, the celebration lasts for 2 days, and some families even set up camp and spend the night at the cemetery. In celebration of Halloween, I wanted to create a string art skull. The first thing you'll need is a flat wooden board. You'll also need black paint. For this project, I decided to use black spray paint to spray my board. You'll also need a skull template and finishing nails. And finally, you'll need a hammer and white cotton twine. Be sure to center your skull template on your board. Please be very careful as you hammer your nails about 1 inch apart onto the outline of the skull template. Now carefully hammer your nails following the outline of your skull template. It should look like this. Now begin by tying your cotton twine to one nail. This will be your starting point, and you can create any design you want. Be creative and just have fun.
Hey guys, what a treat it was for me to hang out with you today. But it's already time for me to go. But before I leave, I'd like to leave you with this. Always make good choices and always stay safe. Until next time, adios.
Ipausum! That means, how are you in the Chickie's language? I'm Ms. Bermudez, and welcome to PBS University for your character education lesson. I was just looking at some funny videos that my friend sent me on the internet. You know, the internet can be such a fun place. You can get funny videos from your friends, find some new recipes, you can message your family, you can find out what your friends are up to and play games with them. But just like anything else, there can be a downside. That's why it's important for us to know some basic safety tips so we can have the best experience possible. That's why today's lesson is internet safety. That's right, internet safety. Internet safety tips for kids. Keep your passwords private. The only person who should know it besides you is your parent or guardian. Do not exchange pictures or messages with strangers. If you want permission to do so, again, you should check your parent or guardian. Do not share personal information. This includes things like the school you attend, your home address, and phone number. Ask permission to download apps and files. Sometimes you might not know that there is a cost or that it requires some of your personal information. This could be the most important tip out of all of them. Never agree to meet up with a stranger. And finally, tell an adult if someone is making you feel uncomfortable. This could include things like being mean, asking for information, or being inappropriate. You should tell an adult right away. Observe these tips when you're on the internet so you can stay safe and, of course, remember to be kind. Now, if we're on the internet talking to our friends and playing games with our family, we can really strengthen the social side of the health triangle. That's right, the health triangle. Do you know what that is? Let's go take a closer look. The health triangle is a way to describe how we take care of ourselves. There are three sides, and each side is equally important. There is the physical side, the social side, and the mental side of your well-being. The physical side includes the things you do to maintain a healthy body. It includes the food you eat, how much rest you're getting, the kinds of activities you do, and keeping your body clean. Your mental well-being can be described as the things you do to keep a healthy mind through the quality of your thoughts, your feelings, and your actions. And finally, we have social health. Social health can be thought of as how well you get along with friends and family at home, at school, and at social gatherings like parties or clubs. Now, which of these sides do you think is most important? The answer is all three are equally important. Here's a quick check for your social health. I show respect for others. I'm a good listener. I have at least one friend I speak to often. I can calmly tell someone no, or I do not agree. Aside from going on social media and playing games and funny videos, I also love to look up recipes and crafts to celebrate the fall. What an awesome season, one of my favorites. In fact, I found a really fun craft that we can make together. So are you ready to make this paper pumpkin with me? Kalman, let's do hamzy, my friends. Okay guys, let's go. One of the reasons I like this craft is because it doesn't require any special materials. Fold the paper and draw half a pumpkin. Then, very carefully, cut it out. This is probably the part that takes the longest, tracing and cutting out all these pumpkins, but it's worth it. The more you have, the better. Between 10 and 20 would be a good amount. You could even have more. Try to cut them out as evenly as possible, but at the same time, it doesn't have to be perfect. I made 12 total, as you can see. Keep them folded and stack them together. Line them up neatly and pin them together. When it comes to the pins, again, more is better. I started off with 2, and then I realized I really needed more, so use a lot of pins. Altogether, I used 4. This is the part that gets a little messy. Next, you're going to get your glue and put it on the edge. Go ahead and rub it across. I went ahead and used my fingers, and then let it dry. While you wait, make the stem by twisting a small piece of paper. Then, if you want to, you can color or paint it. Now I unclipped it and I opened up the dry pumpkin. Then I took the stem and twisted it a little bit more and added some glue. It's time to glue the stem on. You can be generous with the glue because when it dries, it'll actually dry clear. Whoops, it fell apart a little bit. If you have watercolor, lightly paint it. You want to be very gentle so the pumpkin doesn't fall apart. I use orange, red, yellow, and brown. Make sure it's dry and then trim the bottom flat. This is so the pumpkin can lay flat. Ta-da! All done. I made 3 different pumpkins using 3 different types of paper, and they all have their own unique quality that makes it special. Sainama Asi for joining me today, my friends. We really got a lot done. We talked about internet safety, we went over the health triangle, and we made these cute little paper pumpkins. He's a cute little guy. I think between the paper one, the cardstock design, and the paper bag, I think my personal favorite is the one made out of paper. I really had fun with you today, and I hope you join me again. And until then, I want you to stay safe, and I hope that you stay curious. Adios!
Half a day, PBS University friends! Welcome to Chamoru time! I'm Senora Max, and today we are going to learn about... Can you guess why I'm wearing this? Or maybe so we know this could be used as a costume? What about it involves candy? Chocolates, gummies,
sour pops, lollipops, bubblegum. The list can go on and on and on. Can you guess what I'm talking about? That's right, Famagun! Halloween! Can you say Halloween in your language? Awesome job! Halloween in Chamorro means Tempun Nat Manyao. Tempun Nat Manyao. Can you say that? Awesome job, Famagun! You're also going to learn today about Cinco na Sensia, our five senses. Can you say Cinco na Sensia, Famagun? Maulik! Listen, I remember at Nana and Tata's house, at their guma, I remember opening the door and looking out, and all I see are these orange and bright white lights. They were just like this. And I was hearing, ooh, ooh. And I could see like this ghost, this white material, a white cloth moving like this from afar. And it just made me want to go there, guys. Those were things that I can see from my Nana and Tata's guma. What Sensia do you think I would be using for that? That's right, Famagun. The sense to look, right? In CHamoru, we say Senshan Manli'i. Senshan Manli'i. Awesome job, Famagun! And now, Famagun, because of what we could see from Nana and Tata's guma, they saw how excited we were and they said, go, let's go! Go around your neighborhood and start trick-or-treating! Smell my feet, give me something good to eat! Boy, were we jumping up and down because we were just so excited, right? We could smell like chocolate cupcakes. Oh my gosh, do you love chocolate cupcakes? Chocolate itself, vanilla, sweet and sour. We were just going crazy as kids because we could smell all the good in the air. What scents do you think we use, Famagun? That's right, the sense of smelling means Senshan Manningi. Can you say that? Malik Pamagun. We went walking and running, and you can hear our bags as we are going. It was so amazing. We still had long ways to go, but we could still hear, trick or treat, smell my feet, give me something good to eat. Can you say that, Famagun? Trick or treat, smell my feet, give me something good to eat. Malik, Famagun. Now, with this scent, what scent do you think you're using? What? I did give you a clue. Yes. Right? That scent is listen or hear. In CHamoru, that is called Senshan Manhunguk. Senshan Manhunguk. Can you say that, Famagun? Malik, Famagun. And then, Famagun, we got closer to the other guma where they were having parties. There were so many people passing out candies, collecting candies, and there are even haunted houses. I'm so scared of haunted houses. Ma'anyo, I'm so ma'anyo. Are you? The sense of touch in CHamoru means Senshan Manyenti. Senshan Manyenti. Can you say that, Famagun? Malik, Famagun. And the best part, Famagun, is when we are done trick-or-treating and walking around with our familia, we would go back to Nana and Tata's house, spill out our candies, make sure it is safe. Guess what? What do you think we did next? That's right, Famagun. We ate the candies. Oh my gosh, it was heaven. It was candy heaven for us. So what scents do you think we used here, Famagun? That's right. We use the sense of taste. In CHamoru, we say, Sensian Mananya. Sensian Mananya. Your turn, Famagun. Can you say Sensian Mananya? Malik, Famagun. Let's not forget our Sinkuna Sensia. See, Sensian Manli'i. Hear, Sensian Manhunguk. Smell, Sensian Mangingi. Taste, Sensian Mananya. And our fifth one, our Sinku, Sensian Manyanti. Thank you so much for joining me, Famagun. And have a very safe Tempa Natmanyo. Adios!
Fast, fun facts with Mr. Ernest Ochoco.
Hi everyone, this is Mr. Ernest Ochoco, and I'm here with my fast fun fact. And the fact that I'm here, I'm in the forest. This is the beautiful forest that is Maina, and I do love this place because it has so much vegetative beauty. The natural beauty here is really breathtaking. Oh my gosh, look at that. Well, anyway, I want to let you know that I'm afraid because here in Maina, we have the bridge, Maina Bridge, which is home to the legendary Maina White Lady story, right? The myth, the legend. And I'm a little scared, so I brought some friends with me. So, did you guys hear that?
No. Hear what? I heard
well,
you.
Well, I heard that, well.
What does it sound like?
It's like someone walking on a twig or
no
twigs. Okay. Maybe it's just an animal. Yeah. Okay. So let's talk about like what you've heard about the legend, mm-hmm. right? So what did you hear about the legend?
I heard if the white lady is near, you will really smell a heavy scent of flowers.
Oh cool. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like pretty flowers. Yes. I like scents. Oh, yeah. It's like perfume.
Yes,
like
yes.
We're at the DFS. Right. How yes. about you? What did you hear?
Adding on to the flowers, I heard that you could smell the flowers mostly at night.
At night. Mm. Cool. And then I heard that if you could feel like the presence of someone like blowing like wind touching your face. That's what I heard. Yeah. That's what I heard. Like, I know, like, someone's touching you and, like, talking to you. Wait, who's that?
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Run, you guys. Run. Run. Get to the car. Go. I think it's real. Oh, my God. Yeah, I'm okay. Here's my phone. Okay. Wait. Wait. We have to find our keys, you guys. Okay, I'll go.
Okay, we'll watch you from here.
Okay, make sure you watch
we'll
out.
Protect you from a distance.
Oh, okay, I'm gonna go to my phone. But just make sure you guys are here. Don't leave me, got it? Okay. Are you sure? What's up? Oh my
Hafiday students, I'm Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio. For more than a year now, you all have continued to wash your hands and watch your distance from others, and you've done a really great job wearing your masks. We know your parents and guardians have helped you to make these changes to keep yourself and your community safe. As Governor Leon Guerrero said, we are happy you are here. We want you to continue to learn and sharpen your skills with the help of PBS University. This program is the result of a collaborative effort. We couldn't do it alone. I'd like to thank the teachers and support staff of the Guam Department of Education and PBS Guam for their work and their commitment to our students. I'd also like to thank you, students, for participating at home. To your parents, I'd like to thank you for taking an active role in your child's education. We are all eager to return to a time when all of us can share and study together in person. Until then, we hope you learn something new from this PBS University instruction.